Time to give Melania a taste of her own medicine.
Uh-oh. Hello everyone and welcome. Today we answer the question, can you beat Elden Ring? As a Ditto. So you might be wondering, what is this run? Am I gonna cast transform and become a boss? Well, no, that sounds more like an amazing chest ahead video. What we're actually going to be doing is mirror matching every remembrance boss and some minor ones that are along the way. Basically, if a boss drops a weapon, we have to use that weapon to fight it. And just for fun, if I use both weapons, I'll compare and contrast them for anyone out there who hasn't cashed in their remembrances yet, because I'm sure there's at least one of you. Okay, so now you're probably wondering how we're going to do this in new game. After all, don't we have to down the boss to get their weapon? Well, yes, but we aren't. Sure, I could have had a friend drop all the weapons for me, but ha! Imagine playing online. No, that's too easy. Instead, I took my original character who has gone through the game 3 times already and pushed her into New Game Plus 4. Bet that won't come back to bite me in the ass later. For those of you wondering, I did do a little farming before this and I ended up at rune level 240. I know these stats seem kinda high, but really they're just the minimum to ensure I can use every boss weapon available and then a few levels into Vigor, Mind, and Endurance to make them nice round numbers. Okay, I think I've explained everything enough, let me just check my list.
What? That's right, today's video is sponsored by the one, the only, Raid Shadow Legends. Raid Shadow Legends has taken over and gaming will never be the same again. Raid is the first game to bring a true console level experience to your phone. They've set the bar high and there's no going back. Explore millions of champion combinations and master countless tactics as you take on raid bosses, dungeon runs, campaign battles, and PvP arena matches. With hundreds of artifacts to equip and over 600 champions blessed with unique skills, you can build your team, develop your champions, and raid your way. One of my personal favorite champions is Kalia, who's a powerhouse capable of putting out big damage and has a secondary skill that is an AoE that reduces enemy healing. Big damage and less enemy healing? Please and thank you. I also like to put Jintoro on my team because I like the big damage and his skill Oni's Rage does not hold back. Right now, Raid's running an amazing trick-or-treat promotion for Halloween where you can win a bunch of real-life and in-game prizes, including $1,000 Amazon gift cards and some of the best epic and legendary Halloween champions in Raid. The best part? It's all free! And it's super easy. All you need is your Raid player ID. Just download Raid with my link in the description, then head to trickortreat.playarium.com. To make it even easier, I link that in the description too. From there, just enter your details, then spin the wheel and get your prize. That's it. Don't wait around. This special event runs October 15th to November 5th, and once it's over, so be fast. There's seriously never been a better time to get started. But wait, there's more. You can also use the DK Rice's promo code for a bunch of free items to instantly level any of your strongest champions all the way to level 50, 5-star ascension. If you haven't started playing Raid yet, what are you waiting on? Click my link in the description or scan my QR code here on the screen and you'll get unique bonuses worth $30. We're talking a free epic champion Tyrell, 200,000 silver, 1 energy refill, an XP boost, and an ancient shard so you can summon awesome champions as soon as you get in-game. All this treasure will be waiting for you right here. And once again, thank you Raid for the sponsor. Now back to our regularly scheduled programming.
Market is up first, and we are already given a unique situation. See, he doesn't drop a boss weapon, but his later iteration, Morgott, does. It's a choice between either the Regal Omen Briar or Morgott's Curse Sword. If we have to fight regular Morgott later, I decide to use the Omen Briar for Market. Mostly because it isn't upgradable and it has the same damage as throwing slightly damp tissue paper at him. This thing is not the worst. The biggest drawbacks are the insanely slow cast speed and the ridiculous FP cost. However, the tracking on the individual projectiles are actually S plus tier and the scaling on Int and Faith are B, making it a pretty solid option if you don't have aggro.
It's gonna be one of those runs, isn't it?
I bet I'm far enough away from this. It doesn't help that Margit resists holy damage, but years of playing as a mage have taught me effective run away and attack from a distance strategies, and eventually, he goes down. Next up is Godrick, and his boss weapons are either the Axe of Godrick or the Grafted Dragon Fist weapon. Before talking about Godrick or his weapons though, I should probably talk about how I plan to handle upgrading said weapons because that isn't a promising outlook. I was worried that making every weapon a plus 10 would simply trivialize the early game, but being a new game plus 4 with a plus 0 weapon is just tedious. So, my first plan was simply that I would start every fight with an unupgraded weapon, then if I died I would be able to upgrade it one level per death. But I'm at the level of play that's basically is good, but if can choke, will choke. The second plan was that each death would let me upgrade 2 times instead of only 1, but I have the attention span of a goldfish and quickly forgot that. Eventually, I settled on upgrading the weapon to the equivalent level of smithing stone I would have at that point if I were in a regular new game. Okay, now it's time to finally talk about this boss and his weapons. Since Godrick is a two-phase fight, I decided to use both of his weapons. Phase 1 is purely the Axe of Godrick, and you know what? I actually really like this thing.
The range is pretty good, and it's decently fast for such a large weapon. The Ash of War, I command the Neil, is a more unique and cool-looking Ash of War, even if it doesn't do a whole lot. In Phase 2, we switch over to the Grafted Dragon, an admittedly cool-looking fist weapon, but it doesn't offer a whole lot aside from that. See, fist weapons generally don't hit as hard as most other weapons, but they have a nice advantage in that you can power stance them with only one. For example, if you have the Spike Cestus in your main hand and attempt to two-hand it, you actually just equip a second one. This is great because then you can have a fist weapon in the right hand in power stance, and a weapon in the left to two-hand, giving your build a little more weapon diversity without needing to hot-swap weapons. Except you can't do that with the Grafted Dragon. You can power stance it with another fist weapon, but that takes away the pro I just mentioned. Aside from that, it suffers the same issues as any other fist weapon. Low to mediocre damage and itty-bitty range. So what are the upsides to the Grafted Dragon? Well, Bear Witness is pretty cool. But it's really slow, so good luck using on any target after Godric. I mean, the only bosses that will sit still and take it are, what, Phase 1 Rennala and an unaware Draconic Tree Sentinel? As cool as it may be to have a dragon for a fist, I think the Axe of Godric wins this one. Following the progression of a normal challenge run, I make my way to Liurnia of the Lakes. I'm good at this game, you guys, I swear. So what do we have for Rennala's boss weapons? Ah yes, a stick and the moon. Okay, well, Rennala's full moon does do a lot of damage, and the Carrion Real Scepter actually boosts moon sorceries, so that's good. It's not like Rennala has 80% magic absorption or anything, right? Yeah, we're coming back later. I need a second Great Rune to access the capital, and while I do have options, Radahn seems like the best bet. Before heading there though, I decide to start Ronnie's questline, so up at Carrion Manor, Loretta is... there? I'm only using a +3 weapon and she's getting eaten alive. After having a nice chat with everyone's favorite blue doll, I head to Altus Plateau so the Festival of Stars can begin, allowing us to fight General Radahn. You may have noticed during my brief Rennala fight, I was wearing her armor. Just for fun, I decided if I could match the boss's armor too, I would, but Radahn's armor is heavy. Like, really, really heavy, and I didn't put any points into endurance. I'm overloaded just by carrying his set and weapons, but thankfully with the arsenal charm I had just laying around, I can actually bring myself into heavy load. Yep, I'm going to fight General Radahn while fat rolling. For weapons, we have the Lion Great Bow and Star Scourge Greatsword. The bow is slow, but it has a really cool Ash of War, copying Radahn's Rain of Arrows. Except without tracking, making it kinda useless on small and or mobile targets. The swords on the other hand are fantastic, a decently fast swing speed, good poise damage, and a large AoE Ash of War. The only real drawbacks are that they're kinda heavy as it is a colossal sword, and that it has three different stat requirements to use, strength, dex, and intelligence. In the end, the mightiest demigod falls to a cheap knockoff. Me, I'm the cheap knockoff. With two shard bearers down, the only thing standing between me and the capital is an angry man on an angrier horse. The malformed dragon set with the dragon great claw once again puts us into heavy load, but it's fine. The draconic tree sentinel can't hear the clap of our thick greaves as we sneak up behind him and hit him for meh damage. Okay, like, it's actually good damage, but it was also a fully charged heavy attack, so I'm not getting that off again without a stance break. Oh, what's that? Big Unga Bunga weapons are good at stance breaking? Well, hot damn. Before anyone asks, yes, I know I forgot the Dragon Claw shield, I just wasn't thinking while I was doing this fight, and even if I did use it, I would have been over-encumbered, making me have to fight on horseback exclusively, which I suppose matches this fight even more. Funnily enough, I did actually forget a super important weapon in this run. Comment down below what weapon you think it is, and then laugh at my stupidity for having forgotten it. Haha, invincibility frames, asshole. It isn't long before our heavily armored friend goes down and we storm the capital. Up next is the fan favorite, Godfrey. Now, this version of Godfrey doesn't actually give us a remembrance, so my first thought was to do the same thing I did with Morgott and simply use one weapon for this version and the other for the final fight. But then I remembered what the second weapon was. In Ash of War, Horaluz Earthshaker. Do you know why no one ever talks about this Ash of War? Because it sucks. I didn't end up using it in this fight because it's slow and has low damage. I mean, look, here I am using it on the Albernarx to farm, and yeah, it's definitely the cool phase 2 attack, but like 90% less useful. The Axe of Godfrey, on the other hand, is great, but I'll talk a little more about it later on. For now, Axe to Axe, Godfrey to Dust. Is it a little breezy in here, or just me? Finally, it's time for Margit 2.0, so we can use his other weapon, Morgott's Cursed Sword. I'm disappointed in this sword. It's not that it's particularly bad or anything, but it's not particularly good either. It has good range and a decent moveset with wide sweeping attacks. The Ash of War Curse Blood Slice is also a beautifully animated attack, even if it is a little underwhelming. It suffers from the same drawback as the Star Scourge Greatsword, needing an investment in Strength, Dexterity, and Arcane, but having a high Arcane stat will help this thing's passive bleed buildup, which honestly it needs because I think I only proc'd it twice in this whole fight. That all being said, it well outclasses his other weapon, the Regal Omen Brider, by like a lot. Hey Morgott, I can do that too. It's time to fight the Fire Giant, whose weapons are the incantation, Burn O Flame, and Giant's Red Braid. A whip. Not just any whip, a fire whip. For, you know, the Fire Giant. A boss with 50% fire absorption. And is in New Game Plus 4. I'm beginning to think this was a bad idea. It doesn't help that I only made this whip a plus 5, but just in general, whips aren't good. The attack speed is slow, the damage is low, it can't backstab, it can't riposte, and to top it all off, this particular whip requires an investment into Faith as well as Strength and Dexterity. When he shifts into Phase 2, I attempt to try Burn O Flame on him, but I pushed the wrong button and almost died for it, so never again. The incantation itself is actually really strong, if you can hit multiple times with one cast. It also can have an issue against Melania, knocking her into the air, but overall, the whip is better. Not that that's saying much, I guess. To the Giant's Red Braid's credit, it does have some range, and the Ash of War lets me helicopter fire around, so that's cool, I guess. Two attempts, and about 45 minutes later, the Fire Giant goes down. Next up is my least favorite fight in this whole game, Godskin Duo. However, this time, they give a unique spin on a challenge run. To keep in line with the rules, my first thought was to use the Godskin Peeler and only fight the Apostle, but that's dumb. Technically, this boss isn't a remembrance, and so the rules don't have to strictly be adhered to, so then I decided, why not let myself fight both of them with either weapon as it's one boss? But that too was a stupid idea. Not really, I wanted to incorporate Black Flame Tornado somehow, and the safest chance is while the Noble is rolling against the pillar. It was then that someone in my chat had the coolest idea, why not use the Mimic to make it a 2-on-2 mirror match? Why didn't I think of that? So after some strategic repositioning, I summon the Mimic and attempt to switch over to the Godskin Noble set, but in the time it took me to do so, the Mimic got demolished. My menuing wasn't very fast, but this was less than 20 seconds. I know this is New Game Plus 4, but that's a plus 10 Mimic. So, yeah. Great idea in theory, but the duo had other plans. Fortunately for me, the Mimic didn't actually hit the Noble, so I didn't have two angry bosses on me at once, and after a few minutes, they go down. Coming up on Malaketh, we get to wear one of the coolest armor sets in the game, which is also heavy because of course it is. For choices of weapons, we have Malaketh's Black Blade and the Incantation Black Blade. Sure, that's not confusing. The Incantation is kind of slow, but it does shift your hurtbox around a lot. I don't think there would be a good time to use it against Malaketh, plus it does pure holy damage, of which he is very resistant. So here I am shooting it at a bird. And here I am almost getting murdered by the bird. I'm sure someone will ask why I didn't use the Cicada against Beast Clergyman. Because I forgot. Technically that isn't the weapon he drops, so yeah, Big Death Greatsword it is. The moveset on Malaketh's Black Blade is, well, it's just a standard Colossal Sword moveset as far as I can tell, so if you like those, you'll like this weapon too. It does require investment in the face, so maybe a great weapon for corrupted paladins? Who knows. Destined Death is a surprise, cool Ash of War that's useful if it hits. If it hits. Both the Ash of War and the Incantation do the health reduction and health sap thing, so they can really help against bosses with big health bars. The problem being, you'll probably never have a chance to safely use it unless the boss's aggro is on someone else. Or you decide to sneak it in at the end of the fight just to assert dominance on the boss. Sir Gideon Offnir the All-Knowing. I learned something new about him. The scepter he drops is actually a hammer. I had never realized this because I just assumed it was a staff. You know, because he shoots a billion different spells at us. I guess I have noticed that he switches weapons mid-combat, but I don't think he's ever swung a hammer at me. I decided I would allow myself to use both his weapon and the spells he does for this fight. Gameplay. Comet and Comet Azure are really strong sorceries, and the scepter itself is actually a decent hammer weapon. It doesn't take long before Gideon goes down, and we move on to the Giga Chad that is Godfrey. Starting this fight off with Regal Roar, it does 1200 damage. Wow, that's actually really good. It also buffs our physical damage by 7.5%, adds plus 5 to strength, and changes the moveset on our heavy swings. That's pretty solid. Overall, the axe is a great weapon. It's a bit slow for me personally, and I don't like the rolling R1's range, or lack thereof. The 42 strength requirement shouldn't be an issue if the player has been building for it, as this is an in-game boss weapon, but since it is an in-game boss weapon, it might not get as much use in regular new game. I'm pretty sure one more hit is gonna put him into phase 2. The risk I took was calculated, but boy am I bad at math. Not much to say about Horalu the Alpha Chad. At the end of the fight I had a chance to beat him with only my fists and thought that would be funny. Then I couldn't even do a nano's meters worth of damage to him, so I retreated and used the axe like a coward. At this point, all that's left are some optional bosses and the final boss, so over in Nokron, I mirror the mirror of the mirror. I wanted to do this fight fist only just for the laughs, but I spent almost 5 minutes and only did this much damage, so... Wow, look at that! Where did those swords come from? The Regal Ancestor Spirit is, as always, a beautiful, but underwhelming fight. The choice of weapons are the Winged Greathorn and... that's it. The other option is a talisman that restores 3 FP when defeating enemies, so yeah. I'm sure someone out there will ask why I didn't use the Ancestral Infant's head item, and the reason is, I don't hate myself, because it's not the boss's weapon, so it doesn't fit the actual rules of the run. I also didn't bother using Soul Stifler, not for any particular reason, it just doesn't do any damage and only lasts 10 seconds, so I rationalized that it wouldn't be a particularly useful ability in this boss fight. Although, according to the wiki, it doesn't wake up sleeping enemies. Could be useful for the Godskin fight, I guess. Now would be a great time to take on Estelle because we could just grab the Finger Slayer blade and head right there. But do you remember when I said I forgot a boss weapon? Yep, the correct answer was Bastard Stars. So instead, I head north to Castle Soul and take on Commander Nile. I could have used the Commander's standard, the halberd that Nile is using, but I decided to use the Veteran's Prosthesis because again, it's the weapon he actually drops. It's... okay? I mean, it's a decently fast fist weapon, but nothing spectacular. I didn't realize it has lightning on it by default. Don't know how I didn't realize that, all things considered. I did forget to test out the Ash of War, but it's basically the same thing the Commander does, just weaker. This fight took 10 minutes, which is way longer than it has any right to be, but eventually we slashed our way to victory. Next up is a boss I used to hate, but now I really enjoy fighting.
Do you have any idea how little that narrows it down?
Mog, Lord of Blood. Two choices for weapons this time, Mogwin's Sacred Spear and the Incantation Blood Boon. Never mind, one choice for weapon. I hate this thing. Almost every attack is a straight thrust, and it might have great range, but I prefer at least one wide sweeping attack on my weapons. I guess the rolling R1 does have that sweet sweeping action, but it sometimes felt like the character was holding a spear way too close to their body, drastically reducing the range. Maybe that's just me, or the fact that Mog suddenly went Ultra Instinct and wasted over an hour of my time across several attempts. It does have bleed on it, so that's good. But the buildup is low, that's bad, and the swing speed causes it to build even slower, that's worse. At least during this fight we can actually sing along to his knee heal song, but it's not really doing much. Blood Boon Ritual does buff our fire damage, which Mog absorbs 80% of. You know, I hadn't noticed until now, but like, all of the bosses are resistant to their own weapons. I also now understand why several people wanted me to do a Sacred Spear only video. Maybe one day.
I am Melania, Blade of Mikala.
And I am Wolf, Blade of Doom. Which of these two weapons do you think is it's the Hand of Melania. Scarlet Aeonia is a spectacularly beautiful incantation, but it's also incredibly slow and leaves you way open for an attack. As for the Hand of Melania, yeah, it's pretty good. It's a long katana with bleed buildup, there isn't a whole lot to say. Oh, you're wondering about that attack. Well, when she uses it, it's amazing. When we use it, eh. The damage is okay, but the problem is being able to land every attack in the chain. The best thing about it is that it hits multiple times in quick succession, rapidly increasing the bleed buildup, but it doesn't give any hyper armor, and it's even parryable in PvP. But as sweet poetic justice, I couldn't help myself but use Waterfowl to defeat Melania. Now she knows defeat by my hand. Which, in this case, is also her hand. The next boss I decided to take on was Dragonlord Placidusax. Why? Because it takes 500,000 runes to level up and he's the only one left that can give me that. This time around we have the Dragon King's Cragblade and Placidusax Ruin. The Cragblade is a heavy thrusting sword. Yep, that is a very accurate description. Again, I'm not a fan of weapons that don't have sweeping attacks, but this weapon has one of the coolest Ashes of War in the whole game, Thundercloud form. You literally turn into a red lightning cloud and plunge down on your enemies. How awesome is that? Just gonna get some distance? Okay, who was gonna tell me Placidusax had a Giga Pocket Sand attack? We bait the big laser into a corner and the fight is pretty much over at this point, but first I want to use his own incantation against him. Placidus X Rune is the big fire and malaser spell he occasionally does. Sure wish I could have used it in my Dragon Yandere video, but no, it's not considered a Dragon Communion spell. Either way, finishing the fight in style, I'd say the Cragblade is the better choice. At this point, there's only 5 bosses left. Estelle, Lich Dragon Fortisax, Rykard, Rennala, and Radagon. Elden Beast doesn't count. I decided to take out the other Dragon Boss first, and normally I go through the Gargoyles, but Valiant Gargoyles on New Game Plus 4? Nah, miss me with that. Which way do I go down here? I always get lost.
Oh lord, here coming.
Eventually, we make it all the way down to Mog the Omen, and we have 2 options for weapons, Mogwin Sacred Spear and Bloodflame Talons. Never mind, 1 choice for weapon. This is literally just phase 1 of the harder fight, so yeah, but we all know the real boss comes after this. Platforming in a FromSoft game. I'm so good at this game, I made it all the way to the bottom with only 6 speedrun quitouts. Impressive, I know. After definitely knowing which wall is the hidden wall, we descend the roots and take on Lich Dragon Fortisax. Oh no, maybe Fortisax Lightning Spear will do us some good?
New Game Plus 4 was a mistake.
Okay, so the 2 options for Fortisax are Death Lightning and Fortisax Lightning Spear. Both pretty cool moves. I mean, one, you ram forked red lightning into the ground, causing a wave of pure hate to span out. The other has death in the name. The problem is Fortisax is the big resistant to lightning damage and of course can't be afflicted by Deathblight at all. Beyond that, I haven't really been leveling mine this whole playthrough, so now I have 3 choices. Farm runes and level mine, respec, or bash my head against this wall until I win. If you chose option 1 or 2, you're the smart player, but you're clearly new to this channel. After a few practice runs, I found a safe strategy. Basically, run up to Fortisax, fire off a Death Lightning, and then run away completely disengaging the fight. If I'm lucky and get a headshot, I can do double damage, and after a couple hours of throwing myself at this boss, he goes down. Now it's time to take on another boss I was worried about, Rykard. So for this fight, I can use either Rykard's Rancor or the Blasphemous Blade. My first thought was to use the spell to stay out of the lava, and it hits multiple times. My first thought was wrong. My second thought was to use the blade and guard counter the air, which worked better? But are you surprised to hear that it only works for phase 1? I got that cool glitch again where the lava disappears under him, letting me swing for the fences, but I have never once been able to trigger this in phase 2, so it doesn't really matter. As far as the actual weapons go, Blasphemous Blade is clearly better. An overall great moveset and an Ash of War that can trivialize a couple fights, including Melania, but for as cool as this weapon is, I'm not getting past Rykard with it. Let's see, maybe I missed something.
Whoa, what's this? Remembrance of the Blasphemous has a secret third weapon you can get? How did no one ever notice that?
Yeah, Rykard is a gimmick boss. This might have been doable in regular new game if someone dropped the weapon for me, but he gets a pass.
Alright, it's finally time to take on Rennala again. This time I have a +9 scepter. Surely it'll do better.
I hate this game.
Plan B, funny stick go burr.
This is dumb. This is a very dumb way to fight this boss. As for which weapon is better, the Moonspell is cool, but it requires a ridiculous 70 int to cast. The Carrion Regal Scepter requires 60 int, which is also a hefty amount, but it has the added bonus of, you know, being able to cast more than one spell. I guess it's finally time to address the giant space scorpion in the room. Even after having checked multiple times before starting this run, I apparently forgot Bastard Stars. Strangely, I did not forget the Ash of War Waves of Darkness, so here's what I'm gonna do. I'm going to take the Ash of War, put it on a greataxe, then smash Estelle into the ground. Hey, that's not bad damage, except that came from the actual axe hitting the boss. Huh. Even if only the waves themselves hit, it's still good damage, but I know someone out there will complain that this doesn't count, so you know what? Fine. I'll squash Estelle, take his bossle, turn it into the flail, then use that flail to beat the shit out of the other Estelle. Is that good enough? I actually really like this weapon. The Ash of War puts out this huge delayed explosion in front of you. I know in my Witch King video I kinda said the flails suck, but this one ain't half bad. Waves of Darkness is also pretty good. It's an Ash of War that hits all around you in 3 explosions. Overall, I'd have to give it the Bastard Stars, but for once I can say they're both good.
And with that, the time has come. The only bosses remaining are Radagon and the Elden Beast. Conveniently, each of them have their own weapon.
Merica's Hammer is just a solid choice for a weapon. First off, Goldbreaker, super cool attack. Who doesn't want to hover in the air before slamming down with a force of 1,000 stars, launching enemies into the air? It might have three stat requirements, strength, dex, and faith, but all three requirements are relatively low, meaning most any character can use it with minimal investment. The attacks are fast, and being a hammer class weapon, it does decent poise damage. Maybe it's just because I used this weapon extensively during the Thor playthrough, but I was on a whole nother level during this fight. I almost no-hit Radagon. Right up until his stupid teleportation attack. Ah well, moving on to Elden Beast, I switch over to the Sacred Relic Sword, the Bane of Albernarx Everywhere. It's a pretty decent sword. Fast attacks, okay range, a sprinting sweeping attack, yes! Overall, I'd have to say I like Merica's Hammer more, but honestly, they're both fine choices. In the end, I take care of the Elden Beast the only way I know how, with a glorious wave of gold, and we have beaten Elden Ring as a ditto. Special thanks to my patrons, stay beautiful y'all, and a big thanks once again to Raid for sponsoring this video. Until next time, my friends, don't you dare go hollow.